Welcome to the Mad in America podcast, your source for science, psychiatry, and social justice. Hello, this is James, and welcome to episode 8 of the Mad in America podcast. Thank you so much for getting in touch and sharing your thoughts, feedback, and comments with me. I love hearing from you, and if you want to let us know what you think of the podcast, or who we should interview, or make suggestions, you can email us on podcasts@madinamerica.com. This week, we have an interview with Professor Jim Van Os. Professor Van Os is chairman of the Department of Psychiatry and Psychology at Maastricht University Medical Centre and visiting professor of psychiatric epidemiology at King's College Institute of Psychiatry in London. He trained in psychiatry in Casablanca, Bordeaux, and the Bethlehem Royal Hospital in London. He is on the editorial board of European and US psychiatric journals such as European Psychiatry, Schizophrenia Research, Early Intervention in Psychiatry, and the Journal of Psychiatry and Neurological Sciences. In 2011, he was elected member of the Royal Netherlands Academy of Arts and Sciences, and he appears on the 2014 Thomson-Reuter Web of Science list of the world's most influential scientific minds of our time. He is Director of Psychiatric Services at Maastricht University Medical Centre and runs a service for treatment-resistant depression and first-episode psychosis. I was keen to ask Professor Van Os about his views on biological psychiatry, why we should sometimes challenge schizophrenia, psychosis, and other diagnostic terminology, and how he sees the future of mental health care. Professor Van Os, thank you so much for chatting with me for the podcast. Firstly, I wanted to ask a little bit about your background and what it was that led you towards psychology and psychiatry.
Yes, good question. Thanks for inviting me, by the way. It's difficult, I think, because these things are, as we say, multifactorial. But I think what played a role was that there was a lot of mental variation in my family, all sorts of things. So I was studying medicine, and it really made me think about, you know, what sort of help people really require, because it takes a lot of time for people to deal with mental problems. And I saw it was really a process, not a fix. And that people over the years sort of got insight and self-management, and also were thinking differently of the people that attempted to help them, particularly the professional helpers. So they sort of began owning things more over the process rather than delivering themselves to the professional that, you know, who would make them better. So this transformation from being a passive consumer, if you like, of help to somebody who owns his own vulnerability and also tries to compensate it with resilience coming up with self-management and thinking differently about things like medication. It was very instructive to me and very interesting to me as well. So I decided to become a psychiatrist. I already wanted to become a psychiatrist when I started medicine, because I think it's such a huge philosophical and cultural challenge, really, the whole notion of vulnerabilities and mental crises and how we view them and how we deal with them. It's an enormous issue, and a lot of work still remains to be done there, obviously. So that was really what was drawing me in.
It really does go to the core of human experience, doesn't it? And Jim, I've heard from others that when they were being trained, the training they received was quite biological in nature and quite rooted in medication as the main intervention. I just wondered, was that something that you started to question in your own training, or was it some time before you started to think differently about the model most commonly used in psychiatry?
So I think it's very interesting. So I did my training actually in a number of places. I also worked in places like Indonesia and Morocco, and I did my first year of official training in France, in Bordeaux, and then I went to the UK and I trained to become a doctor in the Netherlands. And what was particularly interesting, for example, that I was working in Morocco, and the most popular course there was biological psychiatry, from somebody who had been training in France and was sort of giving lectures about molecular processes and how these would contribute to mental disorders like schizophrenia, bipolar disorder. And then I went to France, and from France to the UK. And in France, very interestingly, there were, you know, there was a lot of interest in biological psychiatry, but there was also a very dominant Lacanian psychoanalytic movement that actually did not oppose itself to biological psychiatry, but merely considered it like an epiphenomenon. And then the way people were receiving diagnoses in France was quite different from the UK. Actually, this was my first paper I wrote, that, that the way mental illness was conceived in these two countries was quite different. Yet, they were hypothesizing also the same biological vulnerabilities or Lacanian postulates, how psychopathology would arise. So I thought it was all very confusing. And I couldn't put my mind what is the truth and how exactly does it work? But at the same time, of course, there was one dominant approach, and that was everybody was receiving medication. So the psychoanalysts would prescribe medication, the Moroccan psychiatrists would prescribe medication, the UK doctors would prescribe medication. And they would prescribe different medications. They would have different theories about the medication. So in France, for example, you would mix medications because they believed mixing medications would be very helpful in dealing with psychopathology. They had special theories about it. Whereas in the UK, this was anathema. You wouldn't do that. You had to have one drug that you would prescribe to patients. So I was sort of asking, well, how solid is all this knowledge, you know, and how much research is really there to back it up? So I think those questions at a very early stage, I think I was led to questioning the whole paradigm because of the practice variation I was exposed to and the conceptual variation I was exposed to in different countries and different cultures.
Well, I'm grateful, Jim, that you and others like you are willing to look critically at the established models and ask what the evidence is, because I think there's a general perception that diagnostic labels are firmly rooted in science and evidence, but that's not necessarily the case for all psychiatric diagnoses, is it?
Yes. Yeah. So this is actually something I learned in France, because a very popular concept at the time there was called non savoir. So basically not knowing, and it actually led me to embrace not knowing as a core value, particularly in the area of psychiatry, where the culture of filling the gap of not knowing with knowledge, culture-bound knowledge. For example, saying there are diseases that depend on brain dysfunction is not core knowledge. It's a cultural solution to not knowing and us being shy telling patients we don't know. But of course, there's huge implications of filling the gap of not knowing with knowledge that is not solid, but is merely a cultural agreement between professionals to hypothesize things in a certain way. But then we don't realize it's a hypothesis anymore. When we say schizophrenia, what we really mean, this is a sort of a hypothesis, but we forget it's a hypothesis, so we convey it as a thing. And then we forget that conveying things like that to patients is an invitation then for the patient to reinvent him or herself along those lines and internalizing the idea, I am a diseased brain. And once people start internalizing that, they are removed from actually the solution. The eventual solution is that you have to start to own this vulnerability in order to start discovering ways of dealing with it and accepting it and of trying to discover new goals that are achievable and give meaning to life despite the limitations you have encountered. So this is a very serious problem, I think. And in fact, I think the whole issue of experience and consciousness is the elephant in the room of psychiatry, because if you look really closely, the way psychiatric knowledge, particularly biological psychiatry, particularly North American biological psychiatry, is conveyed as hardcore knowledge, in the sense that people have symptoms and those symptoms are indicators of brain dysfunction. The whole issue of consciousness and experience and human variation is not there. It's just saying there's a diseased brain, therefore you have these symptoms. And the implicit model below that is brain causes mind, nothing more sophisticated. So the whole issue of what is experience and what is consciousness and what is the relationship between brain and mind is sort of ignored, and it's just reduced to, well, you've got a diseased brain, you have symptoms. And since experience is made by your brain, you are your brain, and if you have a problematic brain, you are your diseased brain. Mm-hmm. So the implicit message is your identity is now one of a diseased brain, and you have to have medications. So you really disempower from the very first moment the people with these mental crises and experiences from actually accessing those and thinking about those and giving them meaning and incorporating them in daily life. So it's a very difficult problem.
It is, isn't it? And it strikes me that patients are almost conditioned to expect a diagnosis as a successful outcome of a consultation. But I think I would have found it liberating if my psychiatrist had said to me, "We don't know what causes your experiences, but we can still help you with them." It's the fear, isn't it, that if I can't be diagnosed, it must be something awful and can't be explained or treated. But just because we can't understand the derivation or underlying cause doesn't necessarily mean we can't help someone.
Yeah, exactly. So I think what we should do is tell people, listen, you're on a journey now. This is you've sort of encountered your sensitivities or there's things in your life that you need to rethink. You're on a journey. I can co-travel with you for a while and help you. And it's your discovery, but there's certainly help, you know, from other people that can be brought to bear on what you're going through now. That's a different message, of course. And it's very interesting to see that how successful, between brackets, psychiatry has become in society. So what we see, for example, in European countries is that there's an ever-increasing demand for mental health services. And the way we measure mental ill health in populations, like, you know, for example, we do huge surveys and apply criteria of disorders to the general population, we find there's a 25% yearly prevalence of mental disorder. And we have mental health services that have capacity for maybe 3, 4, 5, 6% of the general population. Like in Germany, there's a well-funded mental health service that has capacity for 6%. In the UK, it's a bit smaller. It's like 4%. So, and then the big question, so there's a run, you know, from the 25% prevalence, people are running to mental health services in order to receive a diagnosis and treatment. And then, of course, nobody knows how this selection takes place, who is given, who is selected to become a member of the mental health service provision, if you like, and who isn't. But what we see, for example, in the Netherlands, of course, that as more and more bureaucrats are sort of trying to make it possible, because, you know, if you have too much mental health service, it becomes unpayable. There's too much demand, then the service can't provide it anymore. So there's all sorts of selection criteria now for people to come into mental health services, but it doesn't work because you can't predict who is going to have, what sort of outcome people are going to have. So there's a eternal struggle to get into mental health services and waiting lists. And there's nothing in terms of a public health effort to educate people about what is it, you know, what is having a mental health problem? What is feeling down? You know, is it, so we educate them, well, it's a mental disorder, you have to see a psychiatrist or a psychologist. We don't educate them, well, you know, it's got something to do perhaps with the way you live your life. Perhaps you need to make choices. Perhaps it's got something to do, perhaps it's a spiritual problem, you know, a problem to do with the meaning you give to your life and the goals you aspire. to achieve. Maybe there's something you need to rethink some of those and you'll feel better. So this whole educational thing of saying to adolescents, you're depressed when they go through a phase of anxiety and depression, and then they go seek help, is very dangerous. But we've been educating society now that this is the model.
Well, I can confirm that in the UK and the US, and I'm sure the Netherlands and other places too, the public is still talking about chemical imbalances, and it's still talking about chronic mental illness that once you've been diagnosed, unless you rely on something external like long-term therapy or medication, you're unlikely to remit.
So the question now is, and there have been people calling for a public health effort to sort of educate the public about mental experience and mental problems. Particularly in Finland, there's a very powerful public health initiative so that you try to reach out to the general population and explain things in a different way so that they won't run anymore to become a member of the mental health services and look for different ways. So this is difficult. So some countries, they experience with e-communities, for example. So an e-community is somewhere you can go online to meet people with similar problems, for example. So if you're an adolescent and who experiences anxiety and depression, then an e-community is somewhere you can go and share experiences with other adolescents, some of them who have been through this process for a longer time than you have and can explain to you what you're going through and give meaning to your experience, which can give quite good results. So then, you know, even before you you have the question, do I need help, you encounter people who explain to you what you're going through and help you see it for what it is. So the e-communities, I think, is quite interesting. We have one in the Netherlands. It's called Proud to Be Me. This is about people, you know, girls particularly, who experiment with dieting and losing weight and have, go through phases of looking at their themselves and how their body shape might interfere with their lives. Those sort of things. So there's 2 million girls in the Netherlands contacting each other online in this forum, which requires minimal input from professionals, just, you know, they're experts by experience that manage the whole thing. And it's a great public health resource for young girls to help them, you know, go through this process of adapting to their changing bodies, their changing biology, so preventing all sorts of other things, and preventing also that it becomes labeled too soon as a mental disorder, needing admission, needing all sorts of other things. And there's other examples now internationally of these. Mad in America is a very good example as well. It's not a forum for people with certain experiences, but it is also a public health initiative. That's how I see it, of educating people that there's a critical debate. It doesn't say, like, you know, psychiatry is bad, but it tries to constructively reinvent and transform the effort that professionals, you know, apply in psychiatry to a better model that's more health promoting rather than disease promoting.
That's so important, isn't it? And you made me think, Jim, I've been struggling myself with a diagnosed mental illness for a number of years. And in my experience, what's so helpful about being part of an online community is that I can see a number of people whose experiences are similar to mine. But equally important is that I can also see a wide range of experiences that are very different to what I've been through. And that makes me appreciate how wide these definitions need to be. And yet, when I went to see my own psychiatrist, it was a case of, you are diagnosed with this, and therefore you are the same as all the other people in this category, and this is the way we treat it.
Yeah. And I think there's also now an economic argument driving this persistence of the diagnosis and the disorder culture, because in the UK there's commissioners commissioning mental health services, and then it's measured in terms of the output is the number of people diagnosed with a certain disorder. The epidemiological surveys are also counted in terms of the number of people diagnosed with a certain disorder. Managed care in the US is all about diagnosis. Many countries, you can't even get into mental health services without first receiving a diagnosis. Otherwise, your insurer won't pay up if there's no diagnosis. So there's a whole economic perpetuation, I think, of the construct of conceptualizing mental suffering as something diagnosable because of an underlying brain disorder. In the DSM-5 committee, I was a member of the DSM-5 committee, and the initial attempt was to dimensionalize DSM-5, so as to portray mental suffering as something that can go along dimensions from a little bit to very severe, right across the different diagnostic disorders. So much more fluid and natural, actually, and closer to what we actually see and measure in the general population. However, it was shut down halfway the process, apparently because, well, the committee said it was too difficult because there were, you know, what are the dimensions and how should they be measured? And it's going to be very difficult, and reliability, etc. But the real reason, perhaps, this is what somebody told me, it was on the board of the APA, is that there was this fear that if we were going to dimensionalize, if you like, liberate mental suffering into dimensions, making it human because it goes from a little bit to a lot, then insurers might also start to dimensionalize their reimbursements from a little bit to a lot. And this is something that nobody really wanted, because the dichotomous reimbursement issue gives you clarity, and you can calculate and you can project and you can measure much more easily than sort of this dimensional, you know, fluidity of mental suffering. So it wasn't done in the end. And I think it would have been historical if it had been dimensionalized cross-diagnostically, because then the story would have changed. The story a clinician would have to tell a patient, you know, a diagnosis wouldn't suffice anymore. He would be asking, well, we're going to measure your dimensions. And then somebody would ask, well, what are those? And then he would say, well, these are really, you know, this is really mental experience measured from across a severity spectrum, and it would have been different. So there is, though, a little bit of dimensionality in DSM-5. I think this is very encouraging, because autism actually now is dimensionalized in DSM-5 in the sense that it's not anymore a rare disorder, which it was even 10 years ago. It was considered a very rare brain disorder. Now it is a spectrum, and they call it a spectrum disorder, which is strange because, you know, what is that? So I see it as the first admission that things are occurring across a spectrum with a lot of variation from person to person. And it's the closest, I think, DSM-5 got to saying, well, the things we are dealing with are human experience that vary from person to person across the spectrum. It's the same with addiction. There used to be dependence, there used to be abuse. Now it's just 11 criteria, and the more you have, the higher the score on your addiction spectrum or dimension. So I think that's progress. It's a little bit, but it's progress. And I think the next phase will be that there's going to be a spectrum for psychosis. People are going to say, well, this is really a spectrum of human experience that can go from one, you know, from a little bit to a lot. And you actually have a psychological understanding. The spectrum thought is so important because it allows you to have a psychological understanding of what you mean by what is varying across the spectrum. You can't say it's a disease anymore, so these people are abnormal and they've got extreme, you know, brain disease, therefore is that, because if you say it's a spectrum, it means there's a connection with human experience at the lower end of the spectrum. And then what is that experience that you can make a connection to? For example, in the case of schizophrenia, what is it in normal mentation in the general population that connects to the experience of patients that are labeled or diagnosed with schizophrenia. So that it allows you automatically to have a different way of thinking. That's what I like. So now, you know, there's TED Talks of people saying, well, I'm in the autism spectrum and I'm quite high, and that means you are neurotypicals. And neurotypicals can't well understand how I function. So I'll explain it to you, because it's a very rich way of perceiving the world and dealing with your environment, because I can focus and I'm not distracted as much as you are by all sorts of social issues. It can also become a vulnerability, but it depends on the circumstances. So this is a very natural way of explaining things. So that's why I like the spectrum.
It's certainly a step forward, isn't it? And Jim, you mentioned that psychosis is probably part of normal human experience from time to time. It strikes me that that's still a challenging statement to many that are biased towards biological psychiatry. And schizophrenia, psychosis, and other such experiences, should they be in the DSM at all? Should they be a diagnostic category, or are we risking labeling normal human experience as something it isn't?
Yeah, so I think that's a fascinating question and very good question, because the whole thing is, do we really need a DSM? So basically, DSM is a sort of an effort to educate the people that we see mental experience through the prism of pathology and medicine and diseases. But you can also say, why don't we see it through the prism of mental variation in the general population that can go in all sorts of directions? But sometimes people may develop need for care. So maybe what we should focus on is when people feel they're stuck and they need help, you know, by experts, by experience, by psychologists, psychiatrists. Maybe that's what we should be diagnosing. So we could say, people can run into mental crises, or they can have significant mental suffering, but it's not the diagnosis that they need. Is what they need is help in determining what is the matter. So what is happening to you? What has happened in your environment? What has happened to you? What have you experienced in your life that you now have come to this point that you're stuck and can't go any further? If that's the first question, and if you say, I'm prepared to travel with you for a while and see if I can contribute to you solving your problems, and I've got a range of psychotherapies I can offer. I even got molecules you can try, although we don't know very well what they do. And once you're on them, it's maybe difficult to get off them, but you can certainly try. Be my guest. That's a different discourse. So I think the whole idea that there's something that needs to be diagnosed, rather than that people need to develop insight into what is happening to them and why, that is going to require a defocusing on diagnosis as the first step. And we always say, people are so relieved when they know what is happening to them, and they're so relieved when they have the diagnosis. And this is something what I saw in my relatives as well when I was young. So they got the diagnosis, but by the time they received their ninth diagnosis, they were completely fed up with the system, and it wasn't a relief anymore. So there's a downside to that as well. And of course, you can also give a diagnosis saying, you can say, it's not completely random, the expression of mental suffering. Indeed, you can say there's 10 different ways you can think about this. So, if mood is predominant, you can call it the mood syndrome. If it's about social interaction with other people, you can say, it's sort of, it's in that direction. If it's trauma related, you can call it trauma related syndrome. If it's about hearing voices, you can say, you have hearing voices. That's the diagnosis. You can just describe. That's why people like the diagnosis, I suppose, of depression. When you're at a party, you say, I've got depression. But people won't run away from you, because they know depression is about mood. I've got mood, and I know what it's like to be down, so they can relate to you. But if you say, I've got schizophrenia, people haven't got a clue, you know, what sort of mental experience you're referring to that they can relate to their own psychology. So they don't know what to say and run away from you because they're afraid of you. So the I think if there's going to be a diagnosis, just make it something that people understand and can relate to their own experience. So you can say, well, you know, I hear voices, you know, and in the beginning, I didn't understand what was happening, and I had a mental crisis, and I spoke to people, and they helped me, and now, you know, I've got a better relationship with my voices, and I'm okay. So then that's also a way of diagnosing the problem, but you're actually telling people what happened to you. So it's a much better way, I think. The concept of diagnosis and how it can help people, yes, but not by giving a disease, but by giving something that relates to their experience and that they can explain to other people and that other people can relate to their psychology. So then there's understanding all over, I think.
It's key, isn't it, for people suffering mental distress to be able to reach out and find where they can identify with others. And following on from that, Jim, you used the phrase hypermeaning at a TEDx talk in 2014, and I really liked that. It sounded so much more approachable and understandable than psychosis. Is the diagnostic language, medically based terminology and labeling used in psychiatry part of the reason that it comes in for so much criticism, do you think?
So I think that's key. So we have a user research center, and this is actually one of the questions we discussed a lot in the user research center. But you know, what is the word that you can connect to connect the experience to the general public if you are diagnosed with psychosis? And then and this is also that something that was discussed in the scientific field, like aberrant salience, you know, to link that to psychosis. But then, of course, you can make that simple and just say, well, it's about the way we attribute meaning to our environment. It's a very key process that really defines us and drives a lot of our experience. And of course, there's variation. It can go in all sorts of directions, and sometimes we can be frightened by it, or we've had experience in our life that make that we tend to develop you know, very anxious interpretations of the environment. The word schizophrenia doesn't convey anything about that core issue that also people who have been labeled with psychosis or schizophrenia can well recognize this meaning aspect or hypermeaning, attributing too much meaning to the environment, and actually can also explain to other people then what it is they're experiencing. So I think if we continue to use the word schizophrenia and continue to feel very defensive about it in psychiatry, you know, I saw that we're never going to be able to solve this connection problem we have with the people that seek help for mental distress and receive this diagnosis. It's a core issue, and I think it's one of the core issues that psychiatry gets criticized for, and also that psychiatry is not helping to solve, really. So we have a patient organization in the Netherlands, and they published a paper in psychological medicine, and they wrote also to the DSM-5 committee explaining this, and they said, well, we've got an alternative for you. Can you please include that in DSM-5? And they say what we like to include is psychosis susceptibility syndrome, which I think doesn't go far enough, because psychosis is still a bit sort of a mystifying word. So something like hypermeaning susceptibility syndrome, or it becomes very complicated, of course. But I thought it was good in the sense that what they tried to say was that it's not a disease, it's a susceptibility, not even a vulnerability, but a susceptibility. So some people are very susceptible to attributing lots and lots of meaning. That also, of course, can be very advantageous and very important in the arts or in the expressions. So you tell people, look, you've got this susceptibility, you have to learn to live with it, you have to get to know it. That's totally different than saying you've got a brain disease. And this, and they call it syndrome. I also like that because syndrome basically means in medicine, we don't know. So it's a very nice way of saying we don't know, but what we do know is that it's a susceptibility that differs from person to person. So those principles I like very much. And then I think we need a word like low of mood or being anxious. And in the case of psychosis, it could be hyper meaning or attributing too much meaning to help explain it psychologically. So to their credit, I think Psychological Medicine is now going to publish a paper next month. We wrote about the slowly dying concept of schizophrenia. Because I think, very interestingly, it is a concept. It's at the core of everything that needs to change, that needs to be transformed in psychiatry. And it's slowly dying. But I think professionals and those who provide education in psychiatry do not realize it yet enough that it's slowly dying. But you often have that when the concept is really dying, the professionals become more and more defensive until all of a sudden it's gone. And what I think is, because it's such a symbolic issue, schizophrenia, the diagnosis, it's where the biological psychiatry really has been trying to reverse engineer the concept of schizophrenia by looking at case control differences. So scanning people, taking their blood, and doing all sorts of biological procedures to show differences. And it didn't even matter if they were interpretable or replicable. The key issue was to find differences, helping to reverse engineer and validate this concept. But I think with the advent now, science has been sort of looking at itself as well. And you now have science in transition, and you have meta-research. You have people like the open science movement and John Ioannidis, who goes on about, we're keep producing false positive findings, and that's not the way science should proceed. So science is now correcting itself. And I think in the process, this whole notion that you have cases and controls and that science needs to find differences between them so that we can say it exists. A recent example was the Enigma study in Lancet Psychiatry on ADHD that Med in America has been paying attention to. And they said, we found 5 differences between cases and controls in this massive study. Therefore, we have proven it is a brain disease. So that, and it's interesting to see, I know authors on that paper who told the first author, don't do this, it's rubbish, you can't say that. And still the paper was published and still the paper was accepted. So I think to their credit, the consortium, the Enigma consortium that was behind this, there were a lot of people who were bored, by aghast that this was the message. And we're actually very glad with letters that appeared in Lancet Psychiatry saying, and the attention Med in America paid to the issue. So the language and the concepts and the diagnostics and how that is going to change is really now at the forefront of people's attention on the fringes. And I think mainstream now is also developing more awareness. So the fact that we have now an editorial in Psychological Medicine and that we can talk about this in very critical terms shows that I think psychiatry is changing and taking the matter at heart.
That's so important, isn't it? And Jim, I just wondered, if we look to the future and we look to an inclusive method of supporting mental health rather than an exclusive diagnostic or compartmentalized approach, what messages would you give to a group of trainee psychiatrists to help them move towards that vision?
Well, I think paradoxically, I think the best way to go about this is to tell them don't work in the mental health sector because the mental health sector should disappear as a sector. The problem is that mental health is a sector, but it shouldn't be a sector because human experience is not compartmentalized in mental and somatic and local with your GP. So I think mental health sectors should reinvent themselves as inclusive communities, local communities, that are there to connect with people, to give hope, to provide empowerment, to provide meaning, and acknowledge the incredible difficulties that people have because of mental distress. And you don't do that by being a mental health service, receiving people in your office and giving them a diagnosis and seeing them every 2 weeks for half an hour or an hour for psychotherapy or for medication control. You do that by being part of a local community together with people with lived experience, you know, preferably maybe a third of the staff of such a local community needs to be people with lived experience who can help connect, where you can go to and see the same person or persons. Or if you don't like your local community, you go two blocks down to another community outside your living area. But it's not about neighborhood. It's about being able to connect with the community. That's what people that with lived experience, 20 years of literature of people with lived experience has been summarized in these principles. They're called the CHIME principles. What people really want is community, hope, empowerment, identity, meaning, and acknowledgement of the incredible difficulties they have and that the people work with them. So I think, you know, mental health services should reinvent themselves as local communities where you can do open dialogue, where you can do connecting, where you can work with GPs very closely, also because somatic health is a big problem very often, because that accompanies mental distress. And also very close to social services, of course, local social services, because you need work, you need social participation, you need access to all sorts of things. Mm-hmm. So I think trainees should, I think, become aware that what they need to do is become part of a community, that is their goal. And then why do we need psychiatrists? That's an important question, I think. Do we need psychiatrists? And what I think is important is, for example, I've got a colleague who has prescribed at least to 1,000 people antidepressants and know what these molecules can do and can't do and why they and how they can make people worse or ill or psychotic even as well. So I think that type of experience is important. If you want to call that a psychiatrist, that's fine. But it's not the knowledge that we need of psychiatrists. It's their experience. For example, in lithium is a good example. It's a molecule. Sometimes it can be helpful. I have relatives who really swear by lithium, and it has severe side effects. But they do take it because they found out it helps them. So you need somebody with incredible experience with prescribing lithium. And then you can call it a psychiatrist or you can call it a psychologist. And the same with psychologists. Psychologists, you know, psychotherapy is fantastic, but does everything need to be cognitive behavioral? Does everything need to be preceded by CB? Or can you also say, well, you know, mindfulness is a fantastic way of looking at your own mind from a distance and you know, learning how your mind works and how you can also let things go. You don't need to have 8 years training in psychology, learning everything about the brain and learning everything about the cognitive models of the mind. Maybe you just need a lot of experience in yoga or meditation, and you can call that a psychologist. And also, I think what is also clear from psychological research, it's not the technical ingredients of psychotherapy that make things work, but the relationship, of course. So I think we should tell psychologists and psychiatrists, you're practitioners that can add people to bring about change by investing in a relationship. And how do you do that? And what is that? You know, and it's not just empathy and authenticity. It's also the ability to go into a real conflict with another person and resolve it. You know, sometimes people get better through conflicts with other persons. It's not just being empathic and compassion. It's all very important. But also sometimes conflict is a very good way of working with change. So I think it's going to be quite different in the future, and the way we see a psychiatrist and a psychologist and the role of people with lived experience in the community. But those are the things I think we are sort of gravitating towards. And it's very difficult because the whole reimbursement system is now revolving around diagnoses and guidelines for average patients from randomized controlled trials that may not be applicable at all to individual patients, and that also tend to have a sort of a notion of everything is we can make people and we can control everything because of evidence-based practice, forgetting about that patients actually indicate, those with lived experience indicate, what got us better was connection and community and meaning and empowerment and identity. So services are not, for example, now designed to facilitate, for example, the process of developing a narrative of your mental distress, which we know is a very important aspect of getting better in connection with other people. We don't provide that. And when we do, we say it's a three-letter word technique that professionals can be trained in. And then we do randomized trials to see if it works. So I think that's still a little confusing, I think, to how we should deal with that and how we should transform mental health services to not be mental health services anymore, really, but to be transformed into communities.
That community response is important, isn't it? And it does strike me that there's an opportunity for psychiatry to move towards a more holistic, multidisciplinary approach to supporting people, but only perhaps if it reduces its adherence to the biological model and reliance on medication. While you were talking, Jim, you reminded me of something I saw in a documentary the other day. A multidisciplinary medical team were discussing ways to best support their patients and the importance of nutrition, and someone at the back asked the question, do we know if our patients can cook and know what a healthy diet is? So they built kitchen facilities and brought in people to teach cookery, and I thought that was revelatory.
Fantastic. So that kind of thinking really is if you can sort of bring that kind of transformation and implement it at all levels, because you know it's about cooking, it's about making relationships, about having a roof over your head, it's about what to do when you're not well and you need respite for a few days. All those things with a little help can be implemented, of course, but it's outside the box still.
Thank you, Jim. And as we come towards the close, I was reading with interest your involvement in work to help the users of psychiatric medications to withdraw gradually and safely over time. And I just wondered if you could help me understand how that works.
Well, one of the interesting things, I think, is user research. So there's a few user research centers in the world. There's one in London. We've got one here in Maastricht and Utrecht. And I think one of the most brilliant interventions that came from a user research center was an invention by Peter Groot. You mentioned his name earlier, who is somebody with lived experience in the area of depression, and asked himself, well, I've been taking antidepressants for 10 years, do I need them? And organized a randomized controlled trial with himself with tapering strips, allowing him to very, very gradually, because the commercial doses don't allow you to taper gradually. So he made tapering strips for himself to very gradually reduce, but also it was double blind. So he didn't know, he did it for a year, he didn't know when the tapering would start. So he did a randomized controlled trial with himself, and then following what happened to him as he continued to take medication, but he didn't know when, you know, how much the dose would be, when the tapering would start, etc. And then he had experience of mental distress, of depression, of anxiety. He recognized him as being part of the old problem he had, and he unblinded himself, saw that he had been tapering. Then he took the antidepressants again, and he felt better again. But for him, it was a very worthwhile experience because he nearly halved his dose now compared to the previous dose. So he says, okay, so if I need them, maybe for the time being I'll take them, but I only have half the dose. So the medication load is a lot less now for my body. And he's happy with that. And I think that's a very important lesson. I think when we prescribe medication, we should do it in such a way that people are allowed to follow what is happening to them so that they can make their own judgment on whether this stuff is helping them or not. He did it by intensive monitoring of experiences using a technique called experience sampling. So I think we should not prescribe medication and then 2 weeks later ask people, do you feel better? No, we should ask them, monitor yourself. Look for changes in experiences. And then after 2 weeks, I want you to come back and report to me how this drug is affecting you. Is it making you worse? Is it making you better? Or don't you feel anything at all? And of course, the tapering issue is very important. We shouldn't prescribe drugs that are very difficult to then stop, which basically are all psychiatric drugs. They're very difficult to stop. So I think we shouldn't be thinking anymore in terms of I'm going to prescribe for a couple of years or lifelong. I think we should develop models that, like we have for benzodiazepines, for minor tranquilizers now, that say, well, you can get them a few weeks, but then you should stop because they're addictive. Maybe we should have a model with antipsychotics, for example, saying, well, if you're in complete distress and you need something really to ring you down, you can take antipsychotics maybe for a few weeks or a few months, but then you should learn to deal with your experiences like you do with anxiety in psychotherapy. Maybe you should learn to deal with your psychosis as well, with your experiences like hearing voices or being extremely distrustful. Because if you're not exposed to them, you can't learn from them. If you only suppress them, then you can't learn from them. So maybe we should have models where we use the medication just to bring experiences down to the level that you can learn from them so that you can taper off your medication. So tapering strips, I think, are very important and should be reimbursed. They're not reimbursed now. So you get reimbursed to take medication, but you're not reimbursed to get off medication. And I think they should be as important in our daily practice as getting people on medication. And of course, the whole issue of whether medication works at all, the antidepressants, it's very difficult. So probably what we see is that some people have benefits by antidepressants. There's few that undoubtedly have some sort of response that is brilliant. But there's a lot of people that it's unclear whether it does anything. And if it does anything, it's through the relationship with the prescriber. So I think we should be much more careful in concluding that people got better because of the medication, when in fact they got better because for the first time in their lives, they shared their experiences with somebody who was listening to them. That can be such a powerful experience that it starts changing things already. And then we say, well, he got better because of the antidepressant, where in fact he didn't. So we should be much more careful in concluding that there was change because of the antidepressant.
I think this is such valuable work and has the potential to help many users of these medications, and will help doctors too, because it's a shared approach, isn't it? It's that marriage of professional medical expertise and lived experience that makes the most difference, isn't it? Jim, thank you so much for your time today. It was such an interesting discussion, and I'm very pleased to be able to share this with the listeners.
No, we covered a lot. Thanks very much. It was a great interview. Thanks very much, James.
I'm so grateful to Professor Van Os for taking the time to talk with me for the podcast, and I'm sure you found the interview engaging and enlightening. Madden America news and updates. On maddenamerica.com, we wanted to let you know that the Medication Withdrawal Resources page has recently been updated. This page lists providers for support, educational courses, personal stories, websites for advice, research studies, literature surveys, and video content too. If you need help or advice regarding your psychiatric medications, this is a very good place to visit. From the Madden America front page, choose Resources from the menu, then Drug Info, then Drug Withdrawal Info. If there are resources that we should consider adding to the page, you can let us know by emailing the details to info@maddenamerica.com. Finally, if you're listening in iTunes, please leave us a review and a star rating. Your review will really help to get others listening to our great selection of guests. So thank you so much for listening, and please come back next week for another episode. Until then, take care. Thank you for listening to the Madden America podcast. Visit maddenamerica.com for more news, views, and updates.